It's just incredible. So at the moment, we've got 151 participants. It's so exciting. And everybody's all saying hello to each other. And we've got people from Pakistan and from Ukraine and from Poland and Kazakhstan and Russia and I don't know, everywhere. So I'm in Greece. And as I said, it's absolutely beautiful weather here in Greece today. We've been very lucky this April, been lovely, beautiful spring weather. So it's just been glorious. I expect it'll change again before the summer. Anyway, so the purpose of our webinar today is helping young learners to love Shakespeare. All right, so let's see how we get on with it. And the whole webinar, what I've done is I've done everything as if I'm talking to young learners, okay? So it gives you ideas for how you could do such a thing in your class with your primary, with your young primary children, okay? So let's have a look. So the first thing, obviously, when we've got young learners is keeping it simple. But I did think that maybe they could find out a little bit about Shakespeare. So let's see how we can do that. All right, so this is William Shakespeare. All right, he wrote lots of wonderful stories and he lived a long time ago, 400 years ago. Now then, if they're good at maths, you could give them, you know, the date 2016 and the date 1616 and see that, let them do the maths. How long ago was it that he died? You don't have to go into detail with dates, but of course you could also use it as an opportunity to revise dates. The 23rd of April, how we say it, that was when he was born and died. It was the official date of his death, and it's the presumed date of his birth. So to make it neat, we say that he was born and died on the 23rd. They're not 100% sure when he was born, but they do know when he was baptized. So, and that was nearly always 2 or 3 days after he was, after the babies were born in those days. So that's how they know when he was born and died. So, okay, this is William Shakespeare, lived a long time ago. And of course, when we're talking about a long time ago, we immediately start getting a little bit of sense of history. So let's continue that and get the children, I'm talking about very young learners here, and get them thinking about what it was like a long time ago. So what do you think that William Shakespeare had? And we can do this visually. Do you think he had a pen? Do you think he had a pencil? Do you think he had a tablet? Do you think he had a laptop? Or do you think he had a quill? And just looking at that, those pictures, the children might choose a quill. But it is important for us to realize that they don't, the young ones, don't know about worlds without laptops or without tablets. It doesn't occur to them, you see. So it does have to be pointed out that these things are new. They're not new to them. They're just a part of their life. So we immediately want to start getting a sort of sense of history there. That these things are new, but quills are old. Okay. So there we go. He didn't have a computer or a tablet. He wrote with this. It's called a quill. And what is a quill? It's a feather from a bird. Now, of course, what you could do here is you could have fun if you could, you know, we find feathers around, don't we? And I think they sharpened their quills. They gave them a pointed end. So you could have fun playing around with ink and for them trying to write with a quill. Do they think it's easy? Do they think it's difficult? Would they like to write with quills? Do they like their pencils? What do they like best, etc.? So we can, there's all lots of little activities you can do around these very simple vocabulary learning activity here. But also, as I say, it's starting to give them a sense of history, okay? And I think it is something that we can work on there with our children. And then we can say, look, this is Shakespeare's writing. So look at his writing. Can they read any of it? Well, I doubt it because I can't. And it's too blurred anyway. But you can, if on your own computers, you might be able to get a better representation of his writing. And it will be interesting for them to see. And do they like his writing? Do they think they do better than writing than him? And also, I think it's very good to point out Look at all the mistakes he made. And on this bit, he's got lots of sentences crossed out. Well, that's good, isn't it? Because he shows that, you know, if you don't make mistakes, you don't make anything. And I do believe very strongly that I think children sometimes get put off writing because we over-edit their work, whereas editing is actually a very normal part of the writing process, and that we should handle it slightly differently. And so maybe they will get encouraged if they see how many blots and how many mistakes and how many crossing out that Shakespeare did himself. And there's quite a lot of examples you can find. You just put Shakespeare's writing on and go to images in a search engine, then you'll find lots of different examples there. Okay, so we've said that he wrote lots of stories, and then we can tell them that Shakespeare's stories were plays. Now, they probably just know the word play as a verb, you know, I play football, etc. But we can explain to them that plays, this means that people went to the theatre and they watched actors playing the stories. And then we can point out, so this is a scene, this is an artist's impression of a scene from the Midsummer Night's Dream. And we say, look, you know, what can you see in the picture? And one of the actors has got a donkey's head. So that's funny, I'm sure they'll like that. And we can point out to them that some of Shakespeare's plays were very, very funny. I had a lot of fun with it, and people joined in with them as well. Okay, and then we can talk a little bit about where people went, and they went to the theatre, and have the children been to the theatre. And when they went to their theatre, did they have seats? Did they sit down? So the answer will almost definitely be yes. And here's the globe. Here's another artist's impression of what the original globe was like. And of course, now on the South Bank of London, there is a replica globe, which is working theatre. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's they've recreated Shakespeare's original globe theatre. And you can go to the plays there, and you can watch them as you watched Shakespeare's plays. So most people there are standing up. So people, you know, joined in and they interacted with the actors. So this is a nice little bit of history for them as well. And then, you know, we often teach history through kings and queens, rightly or wrongly, but Elizabeth I was a very glamorous character. English children all learn about Queen Elizabeth I. And she was the queen at Shakespeare's time. And she also liked going to the Globe. She was a big supporter of Shakespeare. She liked going to the Globe to watch Shakespeare's plays. And then you can talk about, do you like her dress? Well, I do. It's fabulous. I don't know how on earth she walked or moved in that. And again, if you wanted to, at any of these points, you could go into costumes, couldn't you? You could go into costumes of the ages. What did people used to wear? What did they wear in the 1600s in your country? What did rich people wear? What did poor people wear? All sorts of clothes. And I think getting into clothes and what people wore and how they had their hair is quite a nice introduction to history again. Yes, that's right. Dame Judi Dench played her very well, indeed, yes. All right, and then what we're going to do is I'm going to take you through Romeo and Juliet in as simple a way as possible and give ideas. So Romeo and Juliet is one of Shakespeare's stories. And what I've done in this webinar, in this presentation, I've taken images from the Romeo and Juliet film, which was directed by Franco Zeffirelli. I'm not sure, and in the 60s, I think it was, or in the 70s, must have been early 70s, I think, maybe 1972, I'm not sure. And the stars of that film were Olivia Hussey and Leonard Whiting. I don't know if any of you have seen this film, but it is absolutely fabulous film. Of course, now it is dated, but, you know, Olivia Hussey was so beautiful, and Leonard Whiting was such a lovely Romeo. That it's become a classic, really. There's also for older children, the one that my kids loved is the one with Leonardo DiCaprio. And if you're slightly older, they do need to be a bit older to see this, but you're from like sort of 11 or 12 years upwards, I think they would really enjoy that Romeo and Juliet, which is it's a set in Brazil, I think, a sort of modern day Brazil, but Leonardo DiCaprio is just amazing, amazing Romeo, and it's a very different take on it, but it's all exactly the same language, it's Shakespeare's language. And my kids really got interested in Romeo and Juliet and Shakespeare's language through watching that film, actually. So, yeah, he was, Leo, good old Leo. And he got an Oscar. Hooray! We love Leo. All right, so this is Romeo and Juliet. All right, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how we can tell the story of Romeo and Juliet very simply and suggest activities which we can do in the Young Learner classroom. Okay. So, once upon a time, there was a beautiful girl called Juliet. And she lived in Italy in a town called Verona. All right, so we've already tried to give the children a bit of a sense of history. We can also try to give them a little bit of a sense of geography. And whenever I mention a country in the class, I always get out the map and see if they can find Italy on the map. Here I've just got a small map of Europe. Mostly Western Europe here, actually. But you could get a bigger map and see, can they find Italy? I always start, can they find their own country? And of course, when they're very young, they never can. So it's something we have to teach, and then you practice it again and again. They're always losing where the country is, but they gradually get a sense of there are so many countries in the world. And then you could give them a map outline of Italy, and can they find that boot shape, because Italy is shaped like a boot. Can they find that boot shape on the map, and that's Italy. And then within Italy is the country of Verona. And then you could always go on from that about where people live and where do they live and what does the map of their town, etc., of their country. All right, and this is Romeo. And he lived in Verona too. And he saw Juliet and said, she is very beautiful. All right, of course, in Shakespeare, we had much more beautiful language than that. But I say we're keeping it simple. Romeo loved Juliet and Juliet loved Romeo. All right, the phrase I love you is a phrase that children know anyway. They learn it outside of school, even if they don't learn it in the school. It's one of those phrases. Or people now say, I heart you, don't they? Okay, with the symbol of the heart, I heart you. Anyway, so Romeo loved Juliet and Juliet loved Romeo. So with the very young learners, we can practice saying this, you know, who do you love? And they can think about who they love. You know, I love you, Mum, I love you, my doggy, I love you, my teddy, I love you, teacher, I love, etc., their friends. And you can have a little practice of how you say, I love you. And how do you say it? Do you just say, oh, I love you? Or do you say it with more passion? So we can start to use these simple drama activities of actually getting some expression in our voice, yeah? We can say it in different ways. Okay. And then we can go on from that. He's beautiful, she's beautiful, it's beautiful. And here we can practice the verb to be. So when do we say he and when do we say she? And I think these things, you know, they seem simple, but I think these things need a lot of practice with little ones. And what I do is I get a load of toys. Or you can do it in the class, but it's fun with little stuffed animals and toys. And then you get the children to decide, you know, is this bee, is it a boy or is it a girl? What about the giraffe? Is it a boy or is it a girl? And you put them in different places, the boy toys and the girl boys. And then we can tell them how beautiful. So he's beautiful, you know, the bee's beautiful. She's beautiful. Oh, we're talking about the rabbit. We can guess which one we're saying. And these are just little things that make this drill work, actually. It's just drilling the he is beautiful, she is beautiful, and it's beautiful. It's just drill work, really. But we can do it in more dynamic ways like this involving the toys. Okay. All right, so then we're going on with the story. Right, okay, it already starts getting complicated. The trouble with all of Shakespeare's plays is they are all really, really complicated. All right, so anyway, Romeo's father didn't like Juliet's father. Okay, if you want, you can always put that, you can put all of this into the present tense as well. So, you know, I don't like you. So they were against the marriage. They didn't like it. They said, no, you mustn't get married. Now, you will have to explain what get married means. And, of course, you can do that with pictures. You can talk about weddings that the children have been to. Have they ever been bridesmaids, etc., etc. So you can do a lot of work on weddings and what happens at weddings as well. I haven't gone into that there, but that's another whole slant you can get into. All right, so he said, no, you mustn't get married. Oh, dear. So, okay. All right, so we can talk about, he's forbidding them. So, no, you mustn't do that. So we can work on that language as well. So when do the children hear people saying, you mustn't? All right, you might give them some ideas and then you can let them continue. Maybe their parents say, you mustn't jump on the bed. Or maybe you say, you mustn't play football in the classroom. And then, so let them come up with their own ideas of what their parents tell them they mustn't do at home. And what do you tell them they mustn't do at school? And why do we say we mustn't? We nearly always say we mustn't for two reasons. One is because it's something dangerous, or two, because it's something rude and that will hurt other people, either emotionally or physically. And those are the two main reasons, that we're keeping the children safe or we're teaching them to be polite, we're teaching them to be kind. So we can talk about things with them, and you know, what are the different ways of why are we saying mustn't for these different things. So really you're bringing a little bit of values here to this as well. And then if you want to go on with the drama activities, we think about how do people say mustn't? And do we usually say it quietly or do we say it loudly? So it depends, because it's often much more powerful to say you mustn't to somebody very, very quietly. But in fact, especially in schools, we as teachers, we usually tell them we mustn't do something loudly. So, you know, you must stop playing football. Yes, you mustn't play football. Sit down, go away, get out of here. So once the children have come up with their own ideas of what we say with must or mustn't, then they can practice saying things loudly or quietly. And yes, as Joanna here says, you also need the proper facial expression. That if you say you mustn't play football in the classroom with a smile, nobody's going to take any notice of you. So absolutely, yes. Yeah. So you're going to be showing, you're going to be expressing your emotions physically, through your appearance and through the tone of your voice as well. So all these things are different little drama techniques. Okay. All right. So they were told they mustn't get married, but Romeo and Juliet run away. Okay. So they run away. Now, this is quite an exciting thing. I think children usually like the idea of running away, especially toddlers. But, of course, we're probably not talking about toddlers here. But, okay, so the children, Romeo and Juliet run away and they get married. And they don't tell anyone they are married. It's a secret. Okay, all right. So then we can do some work on secrets. So it's a secret. Now then, it's quite interesting. What do the children think? Is it good to have secrets? Well, you can start up a discussion about this, because sometimes it's great fun to have a secret. If you buy someone a present, but you don't want to tell them about it yet, then that's a secret, and it's a good secret. But, I mean, let the children tell you if they think that's a good secret or a bad secret. Can the children think of any times when secrets are bad? What do they think? Well, of course, secrets can be very distressing for children in classes. They're not good when you're hiding something wrong. That makes you feel bad. It makes you feel very bad if you've got a secret, if you've done something wrong in class, and you know that you should tell the teacher, but you haven't. then that makes a child feel very bad and very worried. And of course, the terrible thing for children is if two friends keep a secret from another friend, then that might make them feel sad and left out. So you can start up a discussion about it, and again, it's an interesting thing to do with values, really, and of encouraging children not to keep such secrets, because the people and don't forget that if two friends keep a secret from another friend, the friend who is left out feels sad, but actually, those two friends who keep a secret, they think they feel good about it, but actually, they don't. They feel bad as well. People don't feel nice when they're excluding someone else. So it might be worth having a little sort of conversation with the children about that. And especially if you do have such issues in your classroom, it might be a way of sorting some of them out. Yes, it is. It's like bullying. It's like bullying, keeping a secret like that. Yeah. But it's in a sort of sly way. It's in a slyer way. So children should be encouraged not to feel like that. Not to do those things. And then again, how do we say it's a secret? Do we usually whisper it or do we shout it? Well, it's a secret. We nearly always whisper it. And then it's fun whispering, it's a secret. And you can do this with any language. You can say the same thing with different tones of voices. Again, it's a drama technique, but it's a way of drilling, practicing language again and again. You say the same thing whispering, say the same thing shouting, say the same thing chanting, say the same thing as if you're angry, same thing loudly, quietly, etc. You're just practicing the same language. Okay. So then there's a fight in Verona. Oh, all right. So there's a fight, and it's a sword fight. Goodness me, how exciting. All right. So, of course, in the actual play, these sword fights are brilliant. Two men are fighting. Their names are Tybalt and Mercutio. Mercutio is Romeo's friend, and Tybalt is Juliet's cousin. All right, you might not want to go into all that detail. As I say, it's really difficult to get it so simple enough, actually. There's so many. I've already left out loads of bits. But anyway, this is the basis of the story. All right, so... all right, oh no, oh dear, how awful. Tybalt kills Mercutio. Oh, it was an accident. All right, well, it's great fun, actually, pretending to kill each other, pretending to be dead. Now, it does have to be controlled in the classroom, obviously. And one way in which you can do it is you can have sword fights with cardboard tubes, and they make safe swords. Look what I've just bought. Hang on, I don't know if you can see it. Wait, there we are. Can you see this? It's a foam rubber sword. Okay. And I've actually just bought it for my little granddaughters. I bought two of them. They're 2 and a half, and they love having sword fights. But you, as I say, you do have to be careful. But this is a harmless one. You can buy this in, like, toy shops. It's just, you see, it's bendy. All right, so it's a foam rubber sword. I can't wait for them. They haven't seen them yet. They're a surprise for them. But cardboard tubes are okay as well. Now then, with the little ones, what you can do is you can explain, of course, with cardboard tubes and with foam rubber swords, they can hit each other's swords. And the thing is that you have to make sure they don't hit each other, all right? But you can have great fun pretending to be hit and pretending to be hurt. Okay, so somebody hits you. Oh! All right. You can overact. You can overact like mad. You can fall down. You could even, if you were in the playground, you could even involve tomato ketchup for fake blood. All right. But that's only, of course, if they're wearing clothes that can have ketchup on them. You know, I think you might have a lot of angry parents, actually. So this is something you could do at home in the garden with the children, but maybe not at school with the ketchup. Forget I said that. All right, okay. But anyway, it is fun to have this sort. And of course, when they see, and you can explain to them that actors don't hit each other at all. They are never hurt. And they just pretend to be hit, and they pretend to be hurt. And it's actually much more fun doing that than actually, and of course you can start hitting each other. And for goodness sake, obviously, you're not going to do this, but you don't let the whole class have a sword fight at once. Otherwise, that's it. You'll just have to be, you'll never get out of the classroom. So you do it in pairs. You get two children out. All right. And pair the children who are, not going to hurt each other. Don't pair enemies. Anyway, but I do believe that you can have fun with all of that. All right. Okay. So Romeo is very angry. Oh gosh, because Mercutio has been killed. Even though it was an accident, you see, Romeo was hot-headed and he got very angry. And then Romeo kills Tybalt. Oh, and that means that he has killed Juliet's cousin. Oh no. All right, this is not looking good, is it? Oh dear. All right, so I'm angry. Now then we can start talking about what it's like when you're angry. So Romeo was very angry. And then let's talk about this with the children. So what do they do? What do you do when you're angry? And give the children some ideas and let them continue. So do they cry? Do they maybe hide in their bedroom? Children often hide if they're angry. Do they throw things on the floor? Or do they maybe run around the garden or run outside somewhere? And you could use this talking about Romeo being angry to talk about anger management. Yes, it is great for role-playing, Tamara. Yes, exactly. So we can play the role of being angry. And then we can think now, it is, as we know, when we're primary teachers, a lot of it is about teaching the children life skills and giving them, building them up with inner resources that they need. So are there better ways that they could handle their anger? Is it better, throwing things around or crying or throwing things on the floor? That's what little children do, like when they're two and a half, maybe three. But gradually, what they need to do is to start to handle their anger better. And the children might be able to give each other ideas, and you could definitely give each other ideas of how you could handle your anger, how you yourself feel less angry. It might be, I think that it's never too young to learn that you always have a choice in how you react to anything. You don't have to let your emotions get the better of you. You feel that they do get the better of you, but you always do have a choice. And learning to count to 10 and to think about things and to think, do I need to be angry now? Why am I angry? Etc. I think it's never too, you're never too young to start to think about these things. And these are things that we can suggest to them. Yes, that's right, that's right. And it's better for them to calm down, etc. Yep. Okay, so now, of course, this is the trouble when one person gets angry, everybody else gets angry. That's the trouble with anger, and you can point this out. So the Prince of Verona is now very angry. He's angry with Romeo, and he says, go away, Romeo. Go away from Verona and never come back. Okay, so he's been told to go away. So, they might think, what would it be like if somebody tells you to go away? How do they feel? So, of course, it's not a good thing, is it? And now everyone's angry. And as I said, that's the trouble with anger. It makes everything horrible. Okay. But you can, if you want to get away from anger now, you can have fun pretending to be the Prince of Verona. All right, so in those days, the Prince of Verona would have been a very grand person. And you could use some simple props and some costumes. How might a prince stand? How might a prince walk and talk? And we can think about those things. Why do some people stand up very straight and talk very well and loudly? And why do some people talk like this? So how might a prince say, go away? So again, these are all simple role plays that we can do. And you could even with the language that we've got so far, you could start to act out a whole little scene of Romeo and Juliet with very simple props and costumes. Okay. Oh dear, now we've got another emotion as well. Now Juliet is very sad. Look at poor Juliet. She's absolutely distraught. So what do then we can think about what we do when we're sad. Now then, maybe we cry. Maybe we hide in our bedroom again. Maybe we even throw our books on the floor. And are some of the things the same as when we're angry? Maybe when we're angry, we're also sad. You know, because when you're angry, you never feel good. And you're sad with yourself, actually, aren't you? You're sad of something. So you could use this to start a conversation with the children about their emotions and what they do. And have they ever felt sad? When do they feel sad? I think that thinking about being sad, that often we just think, well, you're sad when a pet dies, or you're sad when an old person dies. But actually, you know, children aren't always sad at those times. It's adults who make us sad. Children often accept death much more than we think they're going to be, that they're going to do. But they might very well feel sad if two friends are keeping a secret from them. That might really affect them and make them. So it might be that you could start thinking about when do they really feel sad. Okay. And then how do we say things? What is our voice like? How do we sit? You know, are we all running around when we're sad? What are we doing when we're sad? How are we moving? Etc. All right, and then Juliet's mother and father say, marry this man. They don't know that Romeo and Juliet are married. His name is Paris, and we like him. All right, and you can show the children the pictures of Paris and of Romeo. Who do they like? Who do they think looks nice? Well, everyone's going to say Romeo, because look at Paris. Who'd want to get married to Paris? Not me. All right, okay, so Juliet thought, oh no, I love Romeo. I'm married to Romeo. It's a secret, you see. Oh, this secret is going to come to no good, is it? All right, and then, as I say, it's complicated. So this is where the story gets really complicated, but it isn't actually more complicated than your average fairy tale. All right, so what I have done is I've tried to keep it really simple. It took me ages to write a simple version, this simple version of Romeo and Juliet. Keep having to sort of miss things out or think, how can we say this in a simple way? All right, so as you can see, it is complicated, because now Juliet pretends to be dead. Oh, okay. So she drinks a special medicine and it makes her go to sleep, and her mother and father think she's dead, and they are very sad. So the children might or might not have fun pretending to drink poison. It's up to you if you think you want to do this. And then pretending to be dead. As I say, the children might just think it's fabulous fun, because it's the kind of thing that happens in fairy tales. Now then, it depends on... I don't know if you've ever seen animals pretending to be dead to escape something. But it's quite stunning. I once saw a little group of ducks who were being chased by a wild dog, and all of a sudden all the ducks just lay down flat and stretched right down and pretend to be dead. They were completely motionless. You know, animals do this. They pretend to be dead. They play dead. And it's very effective. The dog just went away. I think they can somehow make their heartbeat go very slow. Their pulse rate goes slow as well. I'm not sure about the animals, but it is fascinating, and it might be something that the children have seen as well. So you might want to talk about this. And then, okay, so now Juliet's pretending to be dead, and Romeo now comes back to Verona. All right. And he sees Juliet, and he thinks she's dead. Oh, dear. So it just goes to show that keeping secrets is not a good thing. This is the moral, isn't it? And then he drinks poison, and now Romeo really is dead. All right. Okay. All right. Oh, dear. All right. But Juliet's not dead. Okay. And then Juliet wakes up. I told you it's complicated. Well, you know this. All right, and then she sees Romeo, and he really is dead. And then she's very sad again. And then she kills herself with a dagger. And again, you could have fun with a cardboard tube or something. Obviously, you tell the children they must never play with sharp objects. But pretending to kill yourself and falling down dead is quite a fun thing to do for a child. All right, and then so now they're both really dead. And so now everyone is very sad. All right. And then, of course, and quite rightly now, the Prince of Verona is angry with the two families because they were the ones that caused all of this. And he says, Romeo and Juliet are dead because you were always arguing. Romeo's family and Juliet's family know that he is right. And now they're sorry. But it is too late. All right. So this is, yes, it's very sad, a very sad moment in the story when they realize they've lost these two beautiful people. So, but it is a real moral of the story as well, isn't it? That the anger and the rage and the secrets caused of all this. So here's the moral of the story. Too much passion, too much anger, and too many arguments caused a great tragedy. And I think that is something that children can always learn as well, that if you do things too much, it's often bad, isn't it? You can, if you do things a little bit, then it's okay for everybody. And Shakespeare's stories are always complicated, but you can use scenes and characters. You don't have to use the whole story. You can use scenes and characters to whet the children's appetites. You could introduce them to King Lear raging in the storm. That's a fun bit. Lady Macbeth washing her hands of imaginary blood. Magical Titania or funny old Bottom. He's the one with the donkey's head. I read an interview with the actress Helen Mirren. She played, she's the actress who played the Queen in the film The Queen. You might know her from there, but she's a great Shakespearean actress as well, she was. She's been in lots of films. And she said that when she was young, she was a child, and she started to read Shakespeare's stories, but she wasn't reading the whole play. They're too complicated for children to read. And for many adults, they're too complicated as well. But what she was doing was she was picking out the best bits. And that is actually how we can really enjoy Shakespeare, especially with young learners, picking out the best bits, picking out the best characters and having fun with it. And then when you finished it, you could even end your Shakespeare sessions with a classic scene from The Winter's Tale. This is one of Shakespeare's stage direction, Exit, Pursued by a Bear. Okay, well, that's it from me. Thank you all very much for joining in with all the comments as well. I hope I've given you some ideas. I say it was quite difficult to make the story simple enough. And I don't think all stories can be made that simple, but all of Shakespeare's stories. But I say you can have fun with the different characters. So, thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. And we got 240 people here. I think that's a record. Thank you very much indeed. It's been lovely. And I hope to see you again soon on another webinar. Thank you very much indeed. So over to you again, Henry. Henry's gone. He's gone for a coffee. Henry, come back.
I'm here. Sorry about that. I just had to press my camera. Can you hear me, Jean? I'm here now. So thank you very much.
Yes.
Lots of nice comments.
Lovely. Well, I've finished now. I've finished, Henry. So over to you.
Okay.
Lovely, yes, lots right. of lovely comments. Okay, yeah, so... it's been great. It's been very nice. Everyone been joining in. Very nice. Right, well, bye from me then, everybody.
Fantastic.
Goodbye. Thank you.
Bye, Jen. Bye. Bye. Take care.
Thank you. All right, bye.
Okay, I hope you all enjoyed the first talk this morning with Jan. Stay logged in because, as you probably know, we have two more further talks to come. The next is with Carol Noakes, and that begins at 11 o'clock our time. So currently it's coming up to 2:45, which means we've got a short break for you, which you can use to go away and grab a snack or a drink. But just be sure to be back in front of your computers in about 10 minutes or so when we'll be getting back underway. And in the meantime, we're going to share some useful links with you in the chat box. And okay, Dulcie actually has just shared one with you. So if you're interested, take a look at the Shakespeare on Love infographic on Macmillan Readers. If everybody can see that comment in the chat box there, you can click on the link and you'll go through to the page. Okay. So if you've got any questions, please ask me now. I'll keep the camera on for a few minutes. You are going to get a certificate, don't worry. That will happen at the end of today's talk, so at the end of the final one with Chris. And everything's being recorded, and we will make the slides available to download on the site as well, so don't panic about that either. Okay, brilliant. And here's my friend Will.
Bye-bye.
So bye for now from Will. You'll be seeing me again in about 10 minutes, okay? So stay logged in, and I'll be back on your screens then.
Hi everybody, we're just adjusting the font. Okay. Oh, have we frozen?
Yeah, it's better now. Grand. Enough?
Yeah, that's lovely, thank you. Hi, how are you this morning, people? Okay, so we're looking at performance skills for employability this morning, and with particular reference to Shakespeare, not surprisingly, in this strand. And there are lots and lots of ways, of course, in which Shakespeare's enriched our language and our understanding of human beings and all the rich themes in our lives. And so his writing and his thinking about people has an awful lot to offer us, I think, at work and in life. And we're going to look at some of that this morning. I'm seeing people from all over the place. That's really lovely. So there are a couple of things I'd like to mention. There are lots and lots of approaches to acting, lots of practitioners, of course, like Stanislavski and Chekhov and Adler and Mamet and Meisner. They all have subtly or widely differing approaches, and so what I'm going to use is things that I think are pretty much universal, so as not to have to get into that debate. And also, the body and voice skills that actors use are obviously really key to the application of acting, whether it be acting Shakespeare or anything else, into life. And we've looked at those, some aspects of those, in previous webinars, so I'm not going to retract that, but I really would invite you to go back and look at the other ones that we've already recorded on presenting and storytelling and relationships with the audience, because there we have quite a lot of info about approaches to body and voice based on acting skills. But if anybody's got any questions about that later, I'm really happy to talk about it. Okay, so the first thing that I'm interested in this morning is I'm wanting to move this on. It's not like moving on. Okay. Here we go. That's great. How building a character as an actor helps with our emotional intelligence or our curiosity about others, our understanding of others and ourselves in work and life. And we know that emotional intelligence is a key component for sexual, for successful relationships at work and progression. And so how do we get better at it? Well, acting has something to offer us on that. Okay. So you can see Meryl Streep's quote there. I'm curious about people, she said. That's the essence of my acting. I'm interested in what it would like to be you. And all actors have to imaginatively explore others' thoughts and emotions and motivations and conflicts. And I've got actually another quote here from Sally Field. She said, she's another great film actress. She said, I find that's one of the great things about acting. You have the opportunity to stand in somebody else's shoes, whether it's someone with mental health problems or someone who lives and works in a small town. Each character faces a dilemma in her life. And as an actor, you're able to step into that character's skin, look through her eyes. You leave transformed, a different person, because once you live a little bit of someone's life, it changes you. And that is the whole point here. To understand ourselves better, to understand others better, equips us, obviously, with greater empathy, more ability to create rapport. And some of these universal emotions up here on this slide are the ones that we recognize in ourselves and others. You could subdivide them. But the thing is, some we're more comfortable with than others. Some we experience more than others. Some we judge in others. And acting, because it requires us to inhabit and accept a wide range of emotions by stepping into other people's shoes, we have to see the world through their eyes, interpreted by our experience. It's the way into greater empathy and wider emotional intelligence. You don't get the choice as an actor. To be a skilled actor, you have to be really, really curious about emotions, whether you like them or not. And these are some of the ways that actors will approach understanding a character, aspects to explore. And I think there's somebody said my main emotion is anger. Okay, well, there's a whole other range that are available to you and that other people experience. So some of the questions that an actor will ask in preparing to understand a character are on this slide. Obviously, where am I? What's my world like? What do I say about myself in this play? What do others say about me? What do I want? What is my motivation and my objective? And how do I go about getting that? What does that tell me as an actor? And how do I act on what I want to progress my journey through the story? And what are my primary relationships? Who do I care about and why do I care about them? And how does that make me behave? And where and how do these things shift and change? Now, obviously, these are crucial questions for an actor. But if you think about your colleagues at work and the people you work for and the people who work for you, it's really important to be asking these questions, because otherwise we're just making assumptions about others. And we're very unlikely to be part of or form or lead a high-performing team without understanding. And without understanding, even when it's awkward or uncomfortable for us. Okay? So, as we know, some people are easier to understand than others. And these two very contrasting characters are characters that I have, in my past, played in Shakespeare plays. And in some ways, they couldn't be much more different. So we've got Beatrice here from Much Ado About Nothing, who's witty and independent and headstrong and funny, fiercely independent. In Act 1, Scene 1, she says, I'd rather hear my dog bark at a crow than a man swear he loves me. And we've got Aegeus from Much Ado About Nothing, who is tyrannical, lacking compassion, proud, angry. He comes into the place saying, full of vexation am I, full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia. And he capriciously declares that Hermia must marry Demetrius, or he's quite happy to have her put to death for disobedience, because he's allowed to do that in Athens at that point. Daughters have to obey their fathers or forfeit their lives. He says, I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, I may dispose of her, which shall be either to this gentleman or to her death, according to our law, immediately provided in that case. Pretty chilling, huh? So you can imagine probably which one I felt easier to align with when I was setting out to play them. Beatrice takes a journey through the play. She's really interesting, subtle character. On the surface, she's her wit is directed at Benedict particularly. She's been hurt by him. She still has strong feelings, and she's learnt to use humour and insults to disguise this. And yet she cares very much how people perceive her. So you get a real rich sense of the fact that not everybody is what they seem on the surface. And when she realizes that she's perceived as harsh, she says, stand I condemned for pride and scorn so much? And this changes her. This makes her think. And while retaining her humor and spark, she manages to soften and to open up to Benedick. And while she's finally able to say to him, I love you with so much of my heart that none is left to protest. Still, when she agrees to marry him, she has to tease him. She says, I would not deny you, but I yield upon great persuasion, and partly to save your life, for I was told you were in a consumption. She can't resist it. And Aegeus, sadly, learns very little throughout the course of the play. When, near the end, he learns that Lysander and Hermia tried to flee Athens, he insists that they be punished. And he really has very little compassion still. And it's Theseus, the wise leader, who overrules him. So, in thinking about Aegeus, so Beatrice felt really accessible to me, and Aegeus felt really tricky. But you can't play Aegeus without having some sense of where his pride and anger and want for his daughter to fit into society comes from. He has his own motivations for his behaviors, as everybody does. And sometimes you just have to dig a bit deeper. It was very, very important for him that she had the kind of marriage that was appropriate and that she could therefore be respected in that society. And that's the society he was living in. So we're trying to see through his eyes and not judge him. And that helps with our compassion too. Okay. So interacting on stage, the rehearsal process and the performing process has a great deal to tell us too. And the rehearsal process will vary greatly according to the needs of the play, the practice of the director, and the process of the actors. But the play is the purpose that everyone is serving. So like any high-performing team, they collaborate to achieve the best possible outcome they can. And in life, we change roles all the time. At work, at home, transitioning from one scene or context to another. And rehearsal, or repeated practice and observation, helps us to build the awareness and skills necessary to do this well, to do this skillfully. And these are some of the things that I was thinking about that I think are really great lessons from the rehearsal room, because the rehearsal room is a study in work practice. It requires collaboration, teamwork, letting go of the ego and serving the bigger picture, the play itself. It really, really means taking and acting on feedback and being very proactive while being prepared to let go so that other people's ideas count still, and so that ultimately the vision of the play is served. And so it's very much about awareness and being present. Okay, it's give and take constantly, action and reaction. listening and responding. And I'm going to talk more about that in a second, because listening and responding is at the bottom of it. And it also, of course, gives us a sense of using the stage for particular effect and our physical relationships to other people. And you might want to think about how you use proxemics in presenting and your physical relationships to other people. How do you impact on other people with the way that you respond to them and are aware of them physically and of your own physicality and energy? So thinking about this business of listening and responding, which is probably the key aspect that we think about here. Yeah, Michael Shetlev, this casting director and writer, as you can see, he said, listening is not merely hearing. Listening is reacting. Listening is being affected by what you hear. Listening is active. And as I've said here, I think in a true conversation, we need to prepare to be changed. Not only when you are actively in a conversation with somebody, but we need to really use our awareness all the time, whether it's with one person or many people. And every good actor needs to pay close attention. You're part of a system of interpretation. But that key phrase for me is you need to be prepared to be changed by what you see and hear. Otherwise, you're just another person waiting for the gap so that you can talk. And there's a practical use to this. This quote by Craig Wallace is about auditions. And he talks about the magic that listening creates in an audition process, and I would say by extension in any interview. So by listening, you not only learn more, you have a chance to think, to get to a better solution, and people see and hear it in you. You have a greater impact. And so my top tip for interviews would be give space to breathe, to listen, and to respond. And here I've referenced two acting exercises that are all about listening and responding. And the Meisner exercise is a really quite straightforward one. It's subtler than it reads, but two actors sit opposite each other and they make observations about each other and they repeat what each other says. And all they're allowing themselves to do is to be changed by the other person, to be absolutely in the moment and focused, totally present for the other. And I think you can imagine how that sort of focus helps us to create rapport, but also it teaches us so much about what we notice and what we don't notice. And the text exercise, also a great acting exercise, is where one actor delivers the speech and the other basically just listens really hard and echoes anything that's particularly meaningful to them. So you've got the speaker paying attention, the listener paying attention, and the speaker having immediate feedback about what is meaningful to the audience. So two examples. There are loads of great acting exercises that encourage paying attention and listening and responding, but those are two of my favorites. And what are the applications? Loads. I mean, rapport, self-awareness, awareness of others, the power of particular language and imagery. And one more thought on rehearsals from me and from Clark Peters. Clark Peters says you need to make mistakes in rehearsal because that's how you find out what works and what doesn't. And I could not agree more. If we want to grow and learn, we need to be able to fail. So we need places to create and to practice. And things that don't work aren't failures. They're part of the iteration and learning, which is a hugely important thing to remember. All right, let's have a think about Shakespeare specifically now and Shakespeare's text. So we know from other areas of study that Shakespeare's text has hugely informed our current vocabulary. One of my favorites of all the phrases that still live in English is the be all and end all, which is from Macbeth, which is where Macbeth is really hoping that he'll get away with it and that everything will be straightforward and simple. And of course it isn't. And it still lives with us, this phrase, the be-all and end-all, meaning the whole thing, the last word. And I love that one. So Shakespeare's language has massively informed our rhetoric and our appreciation of great writing. And it's a wonderful practice ground for delivery. And it's a wonderful model from which to explore the structure of great speeches. And I love this quote from Anthony Sher. To enact a dialogue is like food. You hold it in your mouth, you taste it. If it's good dialogue, the taste will be distinctive. If it's Shakespeare dialogue, the taste will be Michelin starred. That's so right. So great texts spark our imagination as an audience, but they also inform us through speaking them about rhythm and flow and muscularity. And these are some of the forms that Shakespeare uses, which are well worth exploring. So back in Shakespeare's day, obviously the importance of public speaking was, the delivery was critical, because only a small proportion of the audience had the ability to read. And when the actors delivered their lines on stage, much of the audience would get the message of what was being said, as much from the rhythm and sound of the words as the words themselves. And these are some of the forms that he uses. So there's rhyming verse, which is driven by iambic pentameter, which you're probably familiar with, which is 10 beats with the emphasis on the second beat each time. Five pairs, da-da, 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 da-da. And he uses blank verse, which is the same rhythm without rhyme. It's not always totally even, that rhythm. It gets broken up depending on what's being said in the speech, but that's the basic form. And he uses a lot of prose without rhyme or regular rhythm as well, particularly in Much Ado About Nothing. You'll see that an awful lot of the play is in prose. And these are some examples of where those varieties come up through the play. So you can come back to this slide later if you want to and have, look up those speeches. Beatrice, that rhyming verse should be Act 3, Scene 1. Apologies for that. That's my typo. But yes, there are examples of all of these different forms throughout the play. And I'll just give you some examples, actually. So I'll give you examples of two of those different forms for the activity that comes afterwards. So Beatrice in Act 4, you know, this is a great example of her railing against Claudio in prose. Is he not approved in the height of villain that hath slandered, scorned, dishonored my kinswoman? Oh, that I were a man! What, bear her in hand until they come to take hands? And then with public accusation, uncovered slander, unmitigated rancor? Oh, God, that I were a man, I would eat his heart in the marketplace. It's pretty passionate, huh? And then when she's speaking in she has a brief moment of speaking in verse, blank verse, using the iambic. What fire is in mine ears? Can this be true? Stand I condemned for pride and scorn so much? Contempt, farewell, and maiden pride, adieu. No glory lives behind the back of such. So, yes, alternately rhyming verse there. And what provokes that in her is the realization that people don't see her the way she thought they did, and she's having a real emotional reaction. So, looking at this slide, some of the activities I'm suggesting. Practicing on his speeches gives us a clue to rhythms and emotionality, vowels and clarity, consonants and muscularity. And so, yeah, I'm suggesting look at speeches, compare the forms of verse, compare Beatrice and Aegeus. She has an easy flow, and Aegeus is broken up verse because of his anger. Yes, somebody said practicing the sonnets is great. It really is. But also, try improvising Shakespeare's verse. Try improvising iambic pentameter. It's really fun. Start with one simple sentence to get used to the beat. For instance, my birthday is the 24th of June. And maybe try a section of your presentation in this form to enrich your sense of rhythm, because it's like a heartbeat. And allow yourself, most importantly, to move with the changes of thought. And think about how the use of physical dynamic in your presentations, think about how you use the space and how you serve your text, your speech, with moving the dynamic on changes of thought. He's also, of course, fantastic for rhetorical devices and structure and imagery in presentations. So I'm suggesting that you look for the rhetorical devices, for instance, imagery, analogy and metaphor and simile. I'm going to suggest a couple of speeches in a moment to look at these, to examine these. Lists of three. Contrasts. Alliteration and assonance. Build step by step. Great speakers use these now, and they borrowed them from the Greeks, and they've certainly borrowed them from Shakespeare. And I just want to suggest a couple of speeches that are really lovely and strong on elements of these. So Mark Antony's speech from Julius Caesar is one. This is a great speech for seeing how an audience comes to a point of collective agreement and changes position. So we know that Mark Antony needs to sway the crowd without overtly criticizing Brutus. And he unites with the audience. He starts off with a rule of three. Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. And it's a contrast with an earlier speech from Brutus. And here it's a lovely rule of three use. And also Mark Antony is saying, crowds, I'm one with you. I'm common with you. He uses lots of ironic use of words and repetition of the word honorable, for instance. It mentions it again and again to describe Brutus and the conspirators, showing that they are anything but honorable. He uses contrasts. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him, and so on. It's a speech well worth diving into. And Titania's speech in contrast, so it's cool and ironic. Titania's speech to Oberon is passionate and full of imagery, and it's direct, and it's direct appeal, full of metaphor and storytelling, and it's heartfelt and emotional. These are the forgeries of jealousy, and never since the middle summer spring met we on hill, in dale, forest, or mead, by paved fountain or by rushy brook, or by the beached margent of the sea, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. She's very clear about what she feels. So dive into those speeches and see what they give you. So there are also lessons from improvisation, not texted speech for business, and loads of organizations now are realizing the value of improvisation and learning improvisation for agile individuals and effective team communication. And I'm just going to reference a couple of things that I think are important here. So why build improvisation skills? Well, as we say, more nimble, more flexible, more open to change. And this is very much back to listening, being wholly present to the offer you're being given and responding to what's being said to reach the desired outcome. It requires flexibility and openness. All the skills of improvisation are collaborative and flexible and working on your feet. And I love this thing by Rob Poynton. I've mentioned it in my storytelling webinar before. He's basically saying everything is an offer. And to use everything as an offer, you need to notice more, which we've already mentioned. You need to let go, which we've already mentioned. And you need to use everything, all the resources at your disposal. And some of the skills required are to say yes to other people's offers and to build on them, to be present, to make your partner look good, to listen and respond to them. Don't block them. And to embrace uncertainty, which means we live in an uncertain world. We might as well embrace it and use what is in front of us. And I've got a favorite activity for exploring these qualities, and it's called, as you can see, pitching the film. And it goes like this. You need three people. Two people are pitching a film idea and talking through the story to a producer. And they're only allowed to use one sentence at a time. So they're listening to each other and building the story on the basis of what the one before said. And the producer can either say, yes, I love it, in which they carry on and build the story further, or he can say, or she can say, no, I hate it, which means you need to change tack while still being true to the story. So you might say, if the producer says, no, I hate it about the gun, you say, yes. And when I say the villain's carrying a gun, I mean a potato gun. It's a really fun exercise, and it requires listening and responding and being flexible and being able to change tack while being truthful. So bringing all of this together for now, Shakespeare's plays are being used very regularly and with success to teach people in business about leadership and presenting. And this is one of the things that I do in the realm of leadership and presenting. I With my clients, I will use specific speeches, not just these ones. We'll look for specific speeches that will help that client, that speaker, expand their style and their choices. And so it enhances their presentation skills by making, in content and delivery, by making them more rounded and trying out things they wouldn't otherwise have tried. And these are some examples of different kinds of leadership you might be looking for, or different kinds of influencing, and some of the speeches that might help you see examples of that. I'm using ones that we've already mentioned for three of the corners: Mark Antony for wise leadership, Titania for compassionate leadership, Beatrice for spirited leadership, and I'm adding one in, Henry V, Act 3, Scene 1, the Once More Into the Breach, Dear Friends speech, which we haven't talked about before, for fiery leadership. It's a great example. So, I'm going to take some questions very soon. I just wanted to say one more thing about Shakespeare's lessons, great actors' lessons in Shakespeare for performance, which is keeping the performance alive. So Macmillan is saying that it doesn't matter if he's done the play 100 times. For the audience, it has to be completely fresh every time. And it doesn't matter if the audience knows the play backwards. We have to treat it as though they've never heard it before. And this is the same when we're presenting and public speaking at work or doing an interview. It doesn't matter if we've given the speech 100 times, if we've given the same answers in an interview 100 times. The audience need to hear them absolutely afresh. We need to be completely present in that moment with those people to have impact. It needs to be new minted. And here, I've got some suggested reading for you. And I'm really happy to take some questions now about the activities, about anything else that you're curious about from performance and its application to life as you see it. So I'm going to put the thank you slide up and very happy to take Q&A. Has anybody got any questions or observations? Anybody want to ask anything? You're very welcome. Would you like me to go back to the reading list? Shall I do that? Okay. People are asking if it's possible to get this in writing. This will be recorded and you can go back to it on the website anytime you like. Okay, lots of thank yous coming through. You're very welcome. Are there any more questions that you're curious about? I think somebody was asking about what level is the reading, is the reading suitable for? It's probably teenage upwards, late teen upwards, I would say. It's there for acting students and improvisation students. So, I mean, you can apply it if you're teaching younger people, but where can I get the certificate? I haven't got a clue. Somebody else will come and tell you that. Thanks for all the shared info. You're very welcome. Any more questions? Life is a stage and we're the actors. That's absolutely true. Okay, certificates shall be emailed later this day. Good, that's the answer to that question. You're very welcome. Thank you for explaining the scenes. Go back and read them yourself. Read them out loud. That's the thing to do. I don't know what TGIs means. Thank you. You're welcome. No, I'm not in a play at the moment. But I've done many in my past. Can you give an example of the first exercise for actors? How would it work? Read Meisner on that. So I say it's basically an observation and response exercise. But if you look up Meisner on the internet, the repetition exercise will be described in much more detail for you if you want to dig into that one. Is there any possibility to get these readings from you or Macmillan? All the plays are on the Shakespeare Strand. So there are seven readings, seven plays that are within the Shakespeare Strand from Macmillan, and yes, you can find them there. Maria, I love your webinars. Thank you, hun. Okay, that's grand. So unless there's anything else, how can I work the main plays of Shakespeare with primary students? There's lots more information on primary students on this part of the Macmillan Shakespeare offering. So have a look at the website. Are there any books on drama techniques based on William Shakespeare? Hundreds. The pitching a play to a director idea was great. Are there any really fun activities you've ever done? Go back and have a look at the other webinars. There are suggestions in every single one of those for other activities. Are there any techniques for modulating the voice for the diverse leadership speeches? Yeah. Again, for me, go back and look at our presenting and our relationship with the audience webinars, where we start to talk about modulating the voice, and the storytelling webinar, we talk about that too. Esther's saying it's hard to find the other webinars. I've tried to find them. Do we have an answer to that?
Yeah, I'll deal with that in a minute.
Okay, we'll deal with those questions in just a minute. All right, lovelies, I'm going to go back to the thank you slide, and it's great to talk to you all again. Take care. Thanks. Bye. Okay. Up. There you go.
Hi, everybody. Firstly, I'd just like to say thanks very much for that, Carol. That was fantastic. Really interesting tips there on how we can use Shakespeare to help our presentation skills. Coming up at 12 o'clock, we've got Chris Rose, who's going to talk about teaching Shakespeare to teenagers, which can often be a bit of a challenge. So that's at 12 o'clock. So we've got a little bit of a break now. I know we've had a lot of questions about certificates. The certificate will be coming at the end. So at the end of Chris Rose's talk, Henry, who will be back by then, will drag the certificate onto the screen, and all you have to do is click download. So it'll be as simple as that, as just downloading the certificate. If you don't manage to get the certificate, if you can't make it to Chris's talk, for example, the webinars will be available on the Macmillan webinar archive very, very shortly, and you can download the certificate from there as well. So if you don't get it today, it's just a case of waiting a couple of days. Okay? Sorry, I'll try and slow down a little bit. Yeah, good point. Okay, so on the Macmillan English website, on the homepage, there's a link that takes you to the webinar archive, which is all our old webinars. Just click on that, and that will take you straight to the webinar archive. And the video of Carol's talk and the other talks for today will be there probably tomorrow, I would have thought. So it'll be up soon, and you'll be able to get the certificate from there. And you will also be able to get the certificate today after Chris's webinar, which starts at 12 o'clock. No problem, you're welcome. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pause the session for now, and Chris will be back at 12 o'clock. I'll come back online at about 5 to 12 to introduce Chris and get Chris set up. So go and make a cup of tea, have a break, and we'll see you back here in about 10 minutes. Thanks very much, everyone, and thanks, Carol.
Obviously, these aren't things that we usually say. As we know, in everyday English, it's far better to say hello, how are you doing, how's it going, rather than hail to thee, you are well met. Because if I was walking down the street and I saw a friend of mine and I said, good morrow, what cheer, my friend would think that I was rather strange, rather unusual, somewhat old-fashioned, or perhaps a little theatrical. But that's okay, because sometimes it's good to be strange and unusual and perhaps a little bit theatrical. If we use these terms, hail to thee, you are well met, good morrow, what cheer, which are all taken from Shakespeare's plays, which are all things that Shakespeare's characters use to say hello, to welcome, to greet each other, we know that we are already in a slightly different place. We're in a slightly different world. Sometimes, by using different words, we can take ourselves out of the classroom. We can use our imaginations. We can find what stuff of dreams we are made of just by changing the words we use. So, hello again, everybody. Well met. I can see there are people here from all over, from Poland, from Russia, from lots of different places. It's fantastic to have you all here. And from Mexico, France, everywhere, Italy. I hope you'll find this entertaining and useful. I want you to imagine that we're not in the classroom anymore, or you're not even at home sitting at a computer. There's a little picture here. I hope you can see this picture. And this picture is of the famous Globe Theatre. This wooden O. So again, I'll sail to the ale to you. Good morrow for those of you who are still arriving. You're filing in. You're coming into the theatre. You're coming into the Globe Theatre. Now then, we're just the ordinary people. We're not the rich people who can afford to sit up there in the balconies. We are just these people here at the front of the picture, standing there. Keep on coming in, keep on coming in. There's a lot of noise, there's a lot of talking around. These people, us, we are called the groundlings. It's what they called the ordinary people who couldn't afford to sit in the rich seats at the cinema, at the theatre, but they had to stand up, and they'd stand there all the way through a Shakespeare play, and they would talk to each other, and they would shout. Nowadays, people get very annoyed if you ever start talking at the theatre, or heaven forbid, if you ever use your mobile phone at the theatre, not good form. But in those days, people would talk as the play was going on and shout. So I'm seeing you all here in ye chat box, and I'm imagining you like the groundlings, all chattering away and commenting as the play is going on. So I want you to imagine you're there, you're one of the groundlings. Imagine, what can you hear around you? What can you see? What can you smell? I think Elizabethan England was probably a bit smellier than modern day England, although even London can be quite smelly even these days. We are here at the theatre. Why are we here? We're here to be entertained. We're here to listen. We're here to watch. We're here to wonder. We are here for a great story. So let me tell you a story. What's a good way for a story to begin? This story begins, as a lot of good stories do, this story begins once upon a time. Once upon a time, there was a king. Now then, this king was a very, very old king. He'd been king for a long, long time. And to be honest, he was a bit fed up of being a king. He was a bit bored with being a king. All this politics, all these meetings, all this intrigue, all these problems he had to deal with, the crown that sat upon his head was starting to feel very, very heavy. He didn't want to be king anymore. He'd had enough. He just wanted to go off hunting in the forests, doing those things that kings do when they're not being kings. Now then, however, this king has got a problem, because this king has no sons. He has no male children. Now then, at the time this story takes place, that kind of thing was a problem for a king. He needs somebody who can become king after him, but this king has no sons. This king has only three daughters. So, what the king decides to do is to give his kingdom to the daughter who loves him most. daughter who loves me most, he thinks I will give all the kingdom to her, and she can go off and be not the king, but the queen. And I'll go off and retire. So this king gets his three daughters together. One, two, three. Finds his eldest daughter, the biggest one, and he says to his eldest daughter, how much do you love me? His eldest daughter says, oh, father, 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 I love you so much. I love you more than I can possibly say. I love you more than there are words to describe love. You see how rich, how vast, how beautiful our kingdom is. I love you all that much. And the king thinks, pretty good, pretty good. I like that. So then he says to the second daughter, the middle daughter, second daughter, middle daughter, how much do you love me? And the second daughter, the middle daughter, said, well, you heard everything that my sister said. Well, father, I love you that much and a little bit more. Pretty good, pretty good, says the old king. I like that. I like that a lot. So then he comes to the third king, the third daughter, the youngest daughter. Now then, secretly, between you and me, this third daughter, the youngest daughter, is the one that the old king loves the most. He's the one who, he's a favourite. She's his favourite. The one he likes the most. So here, he thinks there's going to be something really good here. So he goes up to her and says, ah, youngest daughter, how much do you love me? And the youngest daughter looks up at him and says, you know what? I don't love you. I don't love you at all. I think you're a silly old man. How do you think this story is going to go on? Now then, a lot of you, I'm just managing just about to read all the things you're saying, and obviously a lot of you know this story already. This story sounds like a very old folk tale that could come from many, many different cultures across the world. But this story is actually the beginning of one of Shakespeare's most famous plays, King Lear. A lot of you spotted it. Now then, if you went into a group of teenagers and said, okay, good morning class, this morning we are going to read Shakespeare's King Lear, and gave them all this big thick book, they would probably go, however, if you could just tempt them, if you could just catch their attention by setting up, by not telling them you're going to read some Shakespeare, by telling them this is King Lear, a very serious play, but by just telling them that story, you will probably catch their attention. I've only ever usually done that much of King Lear with a class, because for those of you who know it, you know that King Lear is goes on to become very, very complicated, very dense. It's quite a difficult play. And my goodness, the ending of King Lear is very, very sad indeed. So it's not always perfect for every class, always. But that beginning is great. It's a good way of catching students' attention. Now then, about a year ago, as Edwin said before, Macmillan commissioned me. They asked me to write Othello, to do a version of Othello for them. Now, obviously, this was a great treat. It was a nice thing to do. I thought, fantastic. I can get stuck here. I can work with Shakespeare. This is brilliant. So I got my original copy of Othello and looked at all the wonderful language in it, the richness of it. And then I had to adapt it so that it would be suitable for intermediate and lower intermediate users. And at first, I admit, I felt terrible. I felt really bad, because Shakespeare in Britain, as in much of the world, is a great cultural icon. He's an important character. And here he was, me, taking this wonderful language, this rich language that I use, and chopping it and rewriting it. I felt like a vandal. I felt like a villain. I felt a bit like this man. I wonder if any of you know who this man is. He's not a very famous man, but his name has become quite famous. This man was called Thomas Bodler. Like that. Thomas Bodler. Now, he's not very well known these days, but there is still a verb in English to bodlerize something. If you bodlerize something, it means you make it simpler, but you change it not in a good way, because this man, Thomas Bodler, about 300 years ago, he did a version of all Shakespeare's plays in which he cut out all the bad words, he cut out all the violence, he cut out all those sad endings, and he made everything have a happy ending and be very, very nice and very easy. He's not gone down well in history. Still, his name, this verb to bodlerize, means to change something for the worst. So at first I was worried. I thought I was going to be like Mr. Bodler. I was going to bodlerize this wonderful text, this rich, dark, sometimes difficult, sometimes shocking play. And I felt bad. And I thought, how can I not do that? How can I not do that? And the way I found to not do that was by focusing on one of the things that's at the core of all of Shakespeare's plays. The fact that Shakespeare's plays tell great stories. They're fantastic stories. And sometimes, yes, it meant changing the language, but if I could just focus on the story that's at the heart of the play, I was still being true to the essential spirit of the thing, and as well making it available, making it accessible to many, many more people who probably wouldn't originally go near the original full text of Shakespeare's play. The good thing about these readers, though, is that as well as a simplified version of the text, so we can get hold of that great story, there are still chunks, there are still pieces of the original language that we can compare and look at in detail when we want to look at Shakespeare's great use of language. So you get a bit of both there, a bit of the authentic taste as well as the compelling story. Yep, Isabella's saying the story and the spirit. And felt, yep, engage emotions, absolutely. Okay, so stories. We began with a story. And those of you who've seen me speak before, or seen me talk before, you'll know I work with these things which I call story skeletons or story bones. And there are lots of different ways we can work with these. So here are some story bones. This is a story bones that I have used with groups of teens. And again, this is something that I could use as a prompt for myself. And I would use this to tell a story, asking the students to get involved. I would just at first say, there is a young person. Is it a boy? Is it a girl? How old is this person? 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. The students come up with what they want. They can do it individually, just letting their imaginations take over. They can do it in pairs and tell each other what they're imagining. Or we can do it as a whole group together, when the whole group have to agree on who this young person might be. Then I tell them that this young person has recently sadly been bereaved. This young person has lost one or other of their parents. They feel a bit sad, obviously. Now then, one night, our young person is out and sees a ghost. Ghosts aren't always easy things to deal with, but I find most cultures across the world have some form of a ghost, some form of a revenant, some form of a spirit. They can have different qualities, different valences, different significances in different cultures, but most cultures will understand the concepts of a ghost. And this young person sees the ghost of the parent who had recently died. already. We're into a kind of a story, and the teens I've worked with are already figuring this out. This is kind of a ghost story. It's a mystery story. Maybe not a horror story, but slightly creepy, a slightly disturbing story, especially when this ghost then tells the young person that they were murdered and that you must avenge my death. Spooky, indeed. So keep them simple, yeah. Shakespeare's longer plays do get quite complicated, but if we just narrow it down, filter it down to the bones of the story to keep it simple, tell them as far as that. Get them to imagine who these people are, who they are. They can invent dialogue. They can draw pictures if they like. And they can imagine what will happen next. And this, you can do all of this before you even mention the word Hamlet. Let's look at another one. And again, this is one. Sometimes what you can do with the story bones is do them as a whole class activity. Sometimes you can just write them on bits of paper, print them out, and give them to the students, particularly if they're familiar already with this kind of an activity. Give them to students and ask them, again, in pairs, in small groups, as a whole class, to imagine who these people are. They've got complete free range. This story, two people just got married. Who are the people? Imagine who they might be. Now, one of these people is a good friend, a close friend, somebody they've worked with, somebody they've known for a long time. But this friend, secretly, is very, very jealous. Somebody mentioned before, emotions. Now, Shakespeare's plays are sometimes difficult, they're sometimes strong, and they deal with a lot of negative emotions, as well as the positive ones. This is a story about jealousy. This person is very, very jealous. And because they can't have what they want, they decide to cause trouble. And this friend, the jealous friend, decides to tell the couple. One of the couple is that his new partner, his new husband, their new husband or wife, is not everything that they seem. This is a very simple story bones. It's a very basic one. There's lots of ways you could go with this. Lots of ways the story could end. But again, this is a good way of introducing the story of Othello to your students. Yes, indeed, it is about the green-eyed monster, as Joanna says. It is a good story. It's a very good story. Let's have a look at another one. Here's another one. This is one. I like this one. This one can go in lots of different ways. We've got a group of friends. Mixture of boys and girls. Again, they could be in their teens, they could be in their early 20s. They're all out on a trip. What are they doing? Have they gone on a walking holiday in the mountains? Have they gone on a boating holiday on a lake, on a river? Have they taken a little boat out to sea? I imagine sometimes they've got hold of a car. They're all driving away in a car. Maybe they're going away for a weekend. And suddenly, there's a sudden storm. There's a big storm, a heavy storm. There is rain, there is thunder, there is lightning. They get lost in the fog if they're out walking. Their road becomes flooded so they can't drive anymore, or their boat becomes dangerous and they are stranded. Maybe their car breaks down. They get stuck, they get lost, they get shipwrecked, perhaps, in a place that they don't know. They have to start to explore. They have to do something. What they decide is to go exploring, to look in the land around them where they are. And again, this might be a spooky story. It might be another spooky story. It might be a kind of fantastic story. Perhaps suddenly they find themselves in a strange, magical place. They think something is very different, something very new, very strange in this place that they find themselves. And sure enough, soon they meet a mysterious old man. A mysterious old man who has a very beautiful daughter. Great one to do with teens. Who are these people? They can imagine themselves the friends. They can imagine themselves what will happen. Perhaps everything is not as random as they seem. Perhaps they have been brought to this place for a reason. Perhaps there's a reason why they're all there. Yes, indeed. As Tatiana points out, this is one way of telling the beginning of the Tempest, one of Shakespeare's most mysterious, but for my mind, one of his best, one of his greatest plays. Story bones. You wouldn't be the first person to adapt Shakespeare. Oh, hang on, I've got another one here. This is another good one. I'd forgotten about this one. Again, two friends, two young people, they're out walking at night. Maybe they're walking home from somewhere. They're walking back from their sports club. They're walking back from the gym. Maybe they've been to a party at a friend's house. But they're walking back. Yeah, I think the important thing here is it has to be late at night. And as they're walking along, maybe across the field, down the path, through the park, wherever they're going, they meet another group, a group of strange people. They're all strange again. Strange people who are sitting there out in the middle of the night. Why are these people out in the middle of the night? That's strange. But then these people look at the two friends and say, you, here's what's going to happen to you. Here's, I'm certain, this, you are going to get what you want, but it's not all going to be good. And you, the other one, you're not quite going to get what you want, but you're going to be okay. Two friends, how do the two friends feel? Shocked, disappointed, disturbed? Do they believe them? Probably not. At first they don't believe it, but then some things start to happen. Ina has got this one. This is, again, indeed, of course, in the original, they are witches that the two friends meet. And this is the beginning of Macbeth, which for my mind is one of the greatest openings of the Shakespeare plays. Very creepy, very powerful, very disturbing. But again, you could tell the story in lots of different ways. Tell it as a comedy. Why not? You wouldn't be the first people to have adapted, to have invented, to have experimented with Shakespeare's plays, because not all changes, not all adaptations are Baudelaireizations. There are some very, very good adaptations of Shakespeare's plays. Here are some of them. Some unusual ones, some imaginative ones, some ones that all be good for using with your classroom. If you don't want to use the story bones, or another way of using the story bones, we'll be just showing them bits of these films, or perhaps after you've looked at the story bones. Yeah, some of you know these already. These are some great films. If you look at the poster in the top left, that's quite an old film now. It's a 1950s science fiction film called Forbidden Planet. And even though it looks a bit dated, it's a very, very charming film. For those of you who don't know this film, let me tell you, it's about a group of space travelers. They're in a spaceship far and far away, and their spaceship hits an electrical storm in space and crash lands on a strange planet. And sure enough, on this strange planet where the spaceship crashes, they find out there is already a man there, a scientist who lives there, and he's lived there for a long time on his own with his beautiful daughter, and a robot who does exactly what he wants. Yeah, Forbidden Planet is a science fiction reworking of The Tempest. Great movie. Underneath that one I think probably most of you know, a lot of people never think of this as a Shakespeare adaptation. The Lion King. But there we go. Old Daddy Lion dies. Young Lion has to become. The prince has to go and sort everything out. The Lion King is a great way into Hamlet. Next to that, in the middle, there's one that might be less known. This is a really interesting film. A really powerful film. Quite a strong film. And this film is called This film is set in the southern states of the USA. And it's about a basketball team. And on this basketball team, there is one really good player. They have one really, really strong player. Now, this player is a black guy. He's black, and he's in a team where most of the other people are white. So this is quite a strong film, and it does deal with themes of racism and with jealousy that are at the heart of Othello, or just O, as it's told in this American retelling about a teenage basketball team. A good film. Yep, you're mentioning some of the other great ones. Baz Luhrmann's Romeo and Juliet, which is great. Teens love that. West Side Story, which is just always good for every age. West Side Story is a great one. Romeo and Juliet, I think, is the story that's been told and told and retold so many times. Always good. And as I think somebody pointed out already, the one on the right there, 10 Things I Hate About You, which is a great, really funny, really charming, seems to be a teen high school comedy, very popular with teens all the time. And that is based on The Taming of the Shrew. Doctor Who did meet Shakespeare. Yep, that would be a good introduction to Shakespeare. I'd never thought about that. Lovely. Storybones, versions, adaptations. What else can we do with Shakespeare? Here's a little activity. This is good activity, as well as stories. Great stories. I think one of the things that Shakespeare is so good for, as well as stories, Shakespeare is always great for. Obviously, the richness and the quality of his language. Now, this is a little activity that I've done to get students to learn some Shakespeare, even at pre-intermediate, lower levels. Just learn a couple of lines of Shakespeare, because, as the title of the activity says, you should always brush up your Shakespeare. Brush Up Your Shakespeare is the title of a song from a musical called Kiss Me, Kate. I don't know if any of you know it. And again, that's based on, or works with, The Taming of the Shrew. Again, like 10 Things I Hate About You. One song in this musical called Brush Up Your Shakespeare. It's a great song, really funny song by Cole Porter, who's another very good writer. And in this song, he advises you to brush up your Shakespeare, because knowing just a few lines of Shakespeare is always a great way to impress people. Always looks good. So let's get teens to brush up their Shakespeare, learn a couple of lines. Here's one way I've done it. First, I'd like you to just look at the pictures on the right-hand side of the screen there. These are pictures that I found that Macmillan kindly supplied me with, but they could be pictures of anywhere. We've got five people here. I'm going to talk you through these five people. In the top left, you can see there's a young woman. Let me tell you who this young woman is. This young woman is a very intelligent, a very clever woman. And this young woman is just become, or is training to be, maybe she's just become a lawyer. She's very intelligent, very sharp, very clever young woman. And she's a lawyer. So imagine what kind of things do you think a very clever, very intelligent, very determined young woman lawyer might say. And you can elicit this from the class. On her right, there's another young woman. This young woman's slightly different. This young woman is very, very beautiful. But she's also very innocent and very naive. She doesn't know much about the world. But she's very happy, very positive, very sweet. And then one day, this young woman, who's always very happy, very positive, very sweet, but a bit naive and a bit innocent, goes to, where does she go? Let's imagine she goes out to a big party and she meets lots of people she hasn't met before. How do you think she feels? What kind of things does she say? In the middle, we've got a man. I think this man's a bit older. This man is very serious. This man is, or this man certainly wants to be, a politician. This man wants to be the leader. He wants to be the man in charge. What kind of a man do you think he is? And what kind of things does he say? Bottom left, here we've got a younger man. Now then, let's imagine who this younger man is. This younger man is a bit of a dude. He's a bit cool. He's a bit of the guy who likes himself. He's the guy who walks into your class, sits at the back, and is still wearing his sunglasses. This guy is the guy who thinks he's great. What kind of things do you think this young man thinks? What kind of things does this young man say? In the bottom right is our last character. This young man, he's quite the opposite. This young man, again, this young man is he's a teen, maybe he's in his late teens. He's very, very intelligent, but he's also one of those people who's always very, very worried. He's very anxious. He always worries, he thinks about things a lot. Very thoughtful, very clever. Perhaps he's very quiet and a bit shy. What kind of person is this young man? Is there a person similar to this in your class? And what kind of things would this person say? First, elicit. Get your students to imagine. You can show them pictures, these pictures, other pictures that might resemble the characters more carefully. Or you can just ask students to imagine these kinds of people and what kinds of things they might say. And then once we've got our five people, our young, confident, intelligent female lawyer, our young, sweet, innocent, naive, pretty girl, our man, the man who wants to be a politician, our cool dude, and our troubled intellectual, you might show them some of those texts that are there on the left. And ask your students to think which one of these people would say, to be or not to be? That's the question. Which person do you think would say, friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears? Which kind of person do you think would say, oh, brave new world that has such people in it. Which person do you think would say, the quality of mercy is not strained, it droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven? Which kind of person or which of our people do you think would say, if music be the food of love, play on? And from that, you've got your lines, you've got five famous Shakespearean characters, you've got five great Shakespeare speeches. Get your students to get the first couple of lines of those and brush up their Shakespeare, and they can use those lines in so many different contexts in the future. Shakespeare's language, it's been said before, as we know, pervades modern English, even though this stuff was written 400 years ago, still goes through so many of our everyday vocab, as well as these rich idioms that he has. Okay, let's go quickly. I think I've got one more little activity. This one, I call back translation. It's called back translation. Now then, lots of arguments about the role of translation and the use of L1 in class, whether you should, whether you shouldn't. I'm quite happy to work with a student's first language as in an attempt to learn English, to help them develop their English, comparing, contrasting. This activity works with monolingual classes, which I'm guessing most of you have. Now then, okay, somebody spotted this already. But let me talk you through this. For this activity, you take a text of Shakespeare's. It can be possibly with your class who probably won't be familiar with a lot of this language. I'd use one of the great speeches, you're to be or not to be, our revels now have ended, or one of these. And then you find the translation. Don't worry about the original. You find a translation of this in your language, okay? So your native tongue and the native language of your students. You need about 10, 12, 14 lines of text, depending on how big your class is. Now then what I do is I chop it into lines. So put students in pairs or threes or even groups of four, and I give the students one line each to each group of students. Okay, this is in their own language, remember. So if I was working with a group of French speaking students, I would give one pair of students to comparer je a un jour d'été. If I was working with the Italians, I give posso paragonarti a un giorno d'estate, and so on. Okay, so each pair or small group of students gets one line. They, fingers crossed, almost certainly don't know what this is, and you don't tell them. You just give them the text and you say, okay, can you translate this into English? Each pair or small group of students translate just one line. So it's not much. It's not too much. It's not a great big job. They have to translate this one line into English. And they will come out with, in the case of this example here, can I like you to a day of summer? Depends on the level. They'll come out with something, okay? Then you get the first pair and you ask them to write what they have come up with. Write their translation at the top of the board. Then you get the second pair and they'll write the second line underneath it. Next pair or group, they will write the third line underneath it. Until they've come out with the whole text of 10, 12, 14 lines. And they will come out with something interesting, something good, something which may, to a certain degree, or may not, be similar to this, which you then show the students. And then you can tell the students, well done, you have just rewritten one of Shakespeare's sonnets. Or a great speech from Shakespeare. They can then compare what they've come up with, their translation, with the original. It's very good for looking at particular details of language, some very simple words, how simple Shakespeare's some is, as well as the very less simple and some of the old-fashioned words that Shakespeare uses, thee rather than you, which your students might have come up with, and look at that and then talk about how the language has changed over the last 400 years. It's a good way of having students get a close engagement with a short piece of the text. Okay. I think we're running slightly short of time, so I hope this has been useful for you. Do get in touch with us at Macmillan if you've got any more ideas, suggestions, feedback. I think we're going to be able to take some questions, but before we do, let me thank you and say, our revels now have ended, and if we shadows have offended, think but this and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here, while these visions did appear. Now then, I hope you weren't slumbering or sleeping during this whole webinar, but I think there's a chance to watch it again if you were. But I hope with these, using these more creative, stimulating imagination and engaging emotional engagements, that we did get some visions there, visions of what these plays are, visions of what these stories are, and visions on a more practical level, because that's what we're interested in, of seeing how these plays can help us to learn English. So, good night unto you all, or good afternoon, or good evening to you all. Give me your hands if we be friends. This is what Shakespeare's actors, I think this is from Puck at the end of Midsummer's Night's Dream, and he's asking for, what is he asking for? Your hands. When he wants your hands, he doesn't actually want to take your hands. He wants your hands. With the help of your good hands, gentle breath of yours, my sails must fill, or else my project fails. Which was, please. So I hope this project hasn't failed, and I hope that you are pleased. Thank you very much. Oop. Do ask any questions. It won't be so scary anymore, says Isabella. That's good. Don't be intimidated by it. Break Shakespeare down into small bits. Concentrate on just the stories, one character, or short pieces of text. Other tutorials or videos I've done a couple of webinars for Macmillan before. I think they're still available somewhere on the Macmillan site. I think they're recorded for view somewhere. Shakespeare lesson plans. Yep, they're there and in the readers. Thank you, Lucid. Edutaining. That's a lovely word, Joanna. Thank you. Ah, Lucid is Dulcie. Okay. Okay, well, thank you all. I am judging the competition. Yes, get your stories in. I'm looking forward to it. Get your. I think I'm not. If you can send stories in, but certainly get your students to send stories in as well. Looking forward to reading them all. It was very entertaining last year. So yeah, I'd love to be able to do that. Irina asks an interesting question about acting. I'm not sure about acting. I don't think I'm acting. The great thing about Shakespeare is if you look at the words act themselves. All you have to do is read them out. Read them out carefully. Read them out clearly. Think who's saying them. I'm not a trained actor. I've never done any acting. Don't even like actors that much. Think of the words. Think of the words themselves. The words do the acting for you. That's the great thing about Shakespeare. I'm not working on the Shakespeare reader at the moment, but I would love to do another one. So let's hope so. Thank you all. Thank you for attending. It's been a pleasure as ever. So all the best. Try out the activities. Let us know how they go. Good luck and most of all, enjoy it. Our revels now are ended. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. I hope everybody has enjoyed our webinars today with myself and William and the supporting cast. And I hope you've taken away lots of ideas with you that you can use in your classes next week. So now there is one final act to today's performance, which I'm sure you know what I'm going to say that is. It's a C word, it ends in an A, it's the certificates. So, please stay seated and I will make them available for you to download in the large box which is filling your screen now. Just need to bear with me a few seconds while I pop them in there. And then what's going to happen is you will be able to download three separate certificates as a PDF, which you then need to print off and add your name and signature to. And once that's done, they are yours to keep to prove that you attended the webinar today. As well as the certificates, I'm also popping the competition poster in there too. So I would recommend downloading everything you can see in a large box now, very quickly, just by clicking on each of the individual files and pressing download and saving them to your desktop. If you are having any problems whatsoever doing that, possibly because of the device you're using, then please email us at help@macmillan.com. So what you need to do, just to clarify, is click on the title of each of the files. Okay, click on them. A few people might be having problems. Let me know. Who here is able to download? Let me see. Okay, let me try with another box, because I think a few of you are having problems. So it could be a problem with the name I gave the files. Hang in there, I'm just going to look and change the names. Okay, sorry for the delay. Okay, let's try now. There is a certificate in the new box that I just put up. Please can you confirm if you can download those? Who's able to download that? Okay, I think I know what the problem is. Yeah, we had too long a names on the files, so it wouldn't let it work for some reason. So that's fine. I'm going to put the rest in there now. So you've got the first one. Sorry for the delay with this. And I'm going to put the third one. Okay, so all three are sat in there now. And I'm going to add to that the poster. Please take a copy of that away, put it up in your classrooms. Okay, so that's your lot. They're all there now. I'll give you a few minutes to access them and let me know if you have any problems. For the slides, they will appear separately on our website. So look out from next week, alongside the recording of today, you'll be able to access all of the presentations that you need. So I'm going to stay logged in now for a few more minutes, just to allow you time to download them. If you're still having problems, please write to our customer support team via help@macmillan.com. And we'll get them over to you as quickly as possible. Once again, thank you all for coming. Thank you to our speakers. We're glad you're able to join us today. When I do close down the room in a couple of minutes after the certificates are all sorted, I am actually going to open up a link to a survey, and we'd really appreciate it if you've got time, if you could spend a few moments just filling out our survey to let us know your thoughts on today's events, as that will help us plan future events and try to improve them. Okay, guys. So just to clear up if there's any confusion with certificates, please download them, print them out, and add your name signature. You have to add your own signature. Okay. Right. So it's goodbye from me and goodbye from Will. I'm going to open up the survey now, but take care, everybody. And thanks for being here. We hope you all have taken away a lot from the session. And remember to, if celebrate is the right word, to commemorate Shakespeare's passing on Saturday. Stay in touch with us on our social media channels, because there's lots that will be going up related to William Shakespeare that I'm sure you'd love to have a look at. Okay, so see you at the next webinar, I hope.